In the previous part, we compared cilia and flagella on the basis of their size, function, and the type of movement that they show. Here we are taking the internal structure, which is common. Internal structure is same when we are talking of cilium or a flagellum. Each cilium or flagellum is made up of two main parts. One, there is a sheath which is known as protoplasmic sheath. This is actually an extension of plasma membrane. We'll draw it at the end. And the second part is known as exoneme or axial filaments. In case of cilia and flagella, these axial filaments, they are arranged in a particular manner. There are two in the center part and nine in the peripheral part. And that is why, it is known as 9+2 arrangement. So there are two in the center and nine peripheral. And these are known as the microtubules. Two central microtubules and nine peripheral ones. Nine peripheral ones, they are arranged towards the periphery and they are made up of tubulin proteins and they are in the form of a doublet. We write it as, or we draw it as, this is say a tubule and we are saying a doublet, that means there are two tubules which are together. This is a tubule and attached to it is b tubule. A is slightly inner, B is slightly outer. A tubule has its wall made up of protofilaments. Now I'm making this microtubule here. Suppose this is the tubule that we are making and its wall is made up of these kind of proteins and they are written as alpha and beta tubulin proteins. So say this is alpha, this is beta. So alpha, beta would spirally arrange to make the wall of the microtubule. So this A is made up of 13 protofilaments, whereas B has 10 protofilaments. How do we make those protofilaments? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 and 13. Whereas this has 10. So we make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10. So there are 10 protofilaments in B and 13 protofilaments in A. A microtubule of the doublet has two arms. One arm, which is inner, has a bend-like structure. It is a bent structure. And the outer arm has a loop-like structure. So when we talk of these nine peripheral microtubules, we have to draw these doublets on the periphery. And there are two in the center part. So let us take these two center. We'll start drawing from the center and would go towards the peripheral part. So, say this is one central, one circular, the other one, and each one is 250 angstroms in diameter. So, let us make this tubule. This is the central. Its wall is also made up of the same type of protofilaments, and each has 13. Protofilaments. So we'll have to fill in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 and 13 protofilaments. Here also the same thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 and 13. Out of these two, one is called C1 and the other one is known as C2. Say this is C1 and C2. C is for the central one. So, out of these, there are two, C1 and C2. Each one is 250 angstroms in diameter. And each one is made up of 13 protofilaments. How do we differentiate which one is C1 and which one is C2? On this C1, there are small projections. So if we see projection on any of the central microtubule, that becomes the C1. And the one without those projections is the C2 part. These two are connected by cross bridges. So here there is a cross bridge, and these cross bridges are two. So one and second. These are the two cross bridges with the help of which these two central microtubules are connected. These two are surrounded by a sheath. This sheath is known as the central sheath. So this sheath, which we are drawing here, which is covering the central two, is called the central sheath. We will label all these parts later on once we are done with all the structures. Now let us come to the peripheral nine. To draw these peripheral nine, I'm going to make a larger circle first, and then we will place these nine in this circle. So this is the larger circle. We have to place nine such doublets in this. What we have to remember is A is slightly inner, B is slightly outer. Let me make the dots so that we are able to place all of them properly. Say one is going to come here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So we are able to place all nine peripheral ones here. Let us draw this. Say this is the inner one, A. Attached to it is the outer one, that is B. We said A is inner, B is outer. So we'll make such doublets. This is A, this is B. This one is A, inner, and the outer is B. Outer B, A inner, outer B. This is the inner one and outer. And we are not making it in detail because we have separately drawn it. So let us count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. So these are nine. Let us label some. This is AB. This is A and B. Inner is A, outer is B. Each A has these two arms. So now we have to show these two arms. The arms are, one arm is inner, the other arm is hook-like. One arm is inner, the other arm is hook-like. Inner and hook-like. Same thing here, inner, and the outer one is hook-like. And these two arms are arising from A. And now we have to show the connections. What are the connections? Each A is connected to the next B in a clockwise manner. This is A. So the inner arm of A is connected to B. So from here there is a connection. Connection is between the inner arm of A and B. And this goes in a clockwise manner. So from inner arm to B, inner arm to B, inner to B, inner to B. These are basically linkers, inner to B and inner to B. Let us first erase this dotted line. This dotted line was only to help us draw these nine peripheral ones in a proper circular manner. So once we are done with it, we don't need this reference dotted line. So now let us label few parts here, and then we are going to add few more. Up till now, what we have drawn, this is the central tubule And we know how do we differentiate between C1 and C2. This is known as the central sheath, which is covering C1 and C2. This structure is called the cross bridge. And these smaller ones, which are A and B here, they are together known as the AB doublets. In this doublet, this one is the outer R and this is the inner R. So far, all these structures we have drawn except for one, and we have not labeled it yet, this linker. This is a connection between A and B. So inner arm of A is connected to B. These are called AB linkers. Now let us add one more structure. From each A microtubule arises one radial spoke, which is made up of a dense material. So from here there is a radial spoke which arises, and it has a thickening which is closer to the central sheath. From A up to the central sheath, not touching the central sheath here. So there would be 9 such structures, and they are called the radial spokes. So there are 9 such radial spokes. Let us label this part. This one is a radial spoke. This is the inner part, that is the exoneme or the axial filament 9+2. And the other part is this protoplasmic membrane or sheath. That means this entire thing is covered with the protoplasmic sheath or a membrane. So here there is a membrane which is going to cover this complete structure. And this membrane is actually the outer membrane or the sheath. So this is the sheath. Now when we draw a cilium or a flagellum, suppose this is the membrane, it arises from basal body or basal granule, and this is the cilium or a flagellum. What we do is we make a stretch of plasma membrane which covers the base of the cilium or flagellum. This fold is actually the sheath. So entire filament or cilium is not covered with the membrane. It is only the basal part. That is what we have drawn here. Now, coming to the most important part. What are these microtubules made up of? Out of these, the central ones, the C1 and C2. The C1 and C2, they are made up of dynein protein. C1, C2 are made up of dynein protein. We can write it here, C1 and C2. Dynein protein. Whereas the 9 doublets, they are made up of tubulin protein. AB linkers, these linkers, they are made up of nexin protein. And the arms, the outer and the inner arm, they are also made up of dynein protein. And this is common for cilia as well as flagella. So internal structure for cilium and flagellum, they're exactly same. Now, these radial spokes, we call them, they are made up of dense material. It is also protein, but it is called dense material. So there are different proteins which can be found in cilium and flagellum. The peripheral 9 are made up of tubulin, the central 2 of dynein, arms of A also dynein, and AB linkers, they are of nexin proteins. Now, how does this entire structure work? It works whenever a cilium or a flagellum has to move. We know that in a cartwheel kind of a thing, or if the central part, the axial part, moves, then the entire peripheral structure can also be moved or rotated. So if this part has to move, and because of the movement, these structures should also move, there this connection should take place. So whenever a cilium or a flagellum has to move, this radial spoke touches the membrane. As soon as it touches the membrane, now it is one unit. So if the central part rotates, because all these radial spokes are connected to the membrane, the entire structure is going to move. And for this, energy is required. Energy is available in the form of ATP, where this dynein protein, it is going to act as ATPase. So this dynein protein, it acts as ATPase. And where is this dynein protein present? It is present in the central one, that is C1, C2, and the arms of the A microtubule. When we were talking about the types of cilia, we said we will compare cilia of two types, that is kinocilia and stereocilia, once we understand the structure. So let us talk about the kinocilia and stereocilia. Kinocilia are motile. These are motile. And stereocilia are non-motile. If a structure has to move, then this entire central part should be there. And the movement will always start with the central part. It is exactly like the wheel works. There is an axle and there are two wheels which are attached on two sides. So when the axle rotates, the wheels automatically rotate. And that is why the central part is the most important one. For any structure, circular structure to move, if kinocilia has to move, or these are the mobile ones, then they should have 9+2 arrangement. Stereocilia are not motile. They are not going to move. So why should they have this part, which actually starts the movement? So stereocilia have 9+0 arrangement. The 9 peripheral are exactly same, but the central 2 are absent, because this is the part which actually starts that movement of the complete structure. So this is the difference. If a question is asked, what is the arrangement, microtubular arrangement in cilia and flagella, our answer is going to be 9+2. Question is, what is the microtubule arrangement in cilia? Still our answer is going to be 9+2, because we are talking about the general most common type of cilia, that is kinocilia. Unless and until it is specified that what is the microtubular arrangement in stereocilia, then we are going to write 9+0. Otherwise our answer is going to remain as 9+2. So internally, cilia and flagella, they have exactly same structure, and we divide it into two parts, the exoneme, the central part, that is the microtubular part, and a sheath. The sheath remains only in the basal part of cilia and flagella. The functioning, the movements, we have already studied. So this is the internal structure for cilia and flagella.